we ready? City Press, SABC, Independent, MNG, where is MNG? BLT, News 24. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we can begin. Let me first thank you very much for coming to this media briefing, which is intended to communicate the decisions of the three-day caucus midterm review of lekgotla that took place from the 7th, that was Friday, to the 9th, that was Sunday, this past weekend. So it has come up with a program of action. It has taken important decisions, which we thought we should share with you. And the chief whip is going to go through the statement, a very comprehensive statement, and after which you will get your own copies and will open the floor for questions. Our preferred hashtag is caucus lekgotla, but of course you are free to be creative, but if you are more creative than that, hashtag caucus lekgotla.
Thank you, Comrade Mloto, and welcome, colleagues. Always a pleasure to be with you, to interact with you. We had a midterm lekgotla. Maybe we should explain why the terminology, so that we are all on the same page. I can see that in the statement we have not explained the terminology. We are saying midterm because I think all of us know that as Parliament, we are in the middle of the fifth term of Parliament. So that's why the midterm comes in. But colleagues will also know that as the ANC caucus, we were also holding this lekgotla on the backdrop of the 3rd of August local government elections outcomes. It would have been amiss for any ANC structure, which we are here at caucus, not to interact in this lekgotla, also informed by our not so good performance on the 3rd of August. The last point that I would like to make is that you'll also know that in the fifth term of Parliament of the Republic of South Africa, there are now new players in the horizon, which obviously we would have reflected on. New players here in Parliament, and what does that mean for the African National Congress? You'll also know that this year is this 22nd year of our democracy in South Africa. Therefore, caucus would have looked at where have we been and what have we traversed in implementing ANC policy as parliamentarians for the 22 years or within the 22 years of our democracy. And lastly, we are celebrating 20 years of our constitution this year. So these are all milestones that the lekgotla took into account. We held this lekgotla from the 7th, as you will know, to the 9th of October, to take stock of our performance in Parliament, assess the progress of implementing the movement's policies, and programs, confront and thrash out challenges and obstacles, and reinforce and intensify Parliament's service to the people of South Africa. The midterm lekgotla was attended by ANC members of Parliament, serving in both Houses of Parliament, the National Assembly, and the National Council of Provinces. We also had in attendance, as you will also know, members of the executive. We also had chief whips of ANC, of the ANC in all provincial legislatures, who also came to be part of our lekgotla. The lekgotla was characterized by frank, robust, and intense discussions, enriched by political discussion documents and inputs presented by the Secretary General of the African National Congress, Comrade Gwede Mantashe, and heads of the ANC subcommittees, including Comrade Ayanda Dlodlo, who's the head of our Legislature and Governance Subcommittee of the African National Congress. Also, another comrade who made an input is the head of our Political Education Subcommittee of the National Executive Committee, Comrade Nathi Mthethwa. Of course, the committee or the lekgotla also got inputs from various caucus structures. The midterm lekgotla was candid in its interrogation of prevailing political challenges facing the ANC both within and outside of Parliament, and in its reflection on the task that lies ahead to reinforce the movement as a dependable, trustworthy, and accountable force to intensify the project of liberating South Africans from poverty, unemployment, and inequality. There was unanimity in the view that the movement, its quality service delivery track record notwithstanding, was plagued by credibility and image challenges, which is a consequence of either its inaction or action in dealing with certain issues that confronted it. Whether such a view of the movement is driven by perceptions or reality is inconsequential. The ANC is duty-bound to self-introspect, self-correct, and make itself worthy of the trust and confidence of the people of this country. The movement has a responsibility to restore both the dignity of Parliament and our credibility in it. And this must be felt in the manner in which we exercise oversight, the caliber of decisions we take, and the standard of laws we pass. Parliament is a critical site for the advancement of our program for radical socio-economic transformation, and therefore a site within which the ANC must win the confidence, hearts, and minds of our people. The heightened interest in the function of Parliament, although in certain respect induced by gimmickry from certain quarters than substance, bodes well for the public accountability and scrutiny in the performance of public representatives. Members of Parliament, including how they conduct themselves, are continually under a watchful eye of the public. The midterm lekgotla has therefore committed to cleanse and detoxify itself of the reputational impairment, ensuring a radical shift and improvement in how we function in Parliament. The unanimous and unambiguous consensus emerging out of this lekgotla is that it shall no longer be business as usual. The ANC in Parliament will, in both words and deed, regain moral high ground, vigorously advance clean governance, champion the fight against corruption, shun incompetence, and decisively deal with ill-discipline. Ethical moral uprightness shall serve as the guiding principle of our parliamentary work. The Constitution is the creator of the many years of the people's glorious struggle led by the ANC, and the ANC must thus be seen to be its chief defender and champion. The caucus, together with its study groups, made up of ANC MPs in portfolio committees, must never regularize what is wrong. Instead, it must resolutely strive for strict adherence to the founding values of our Constitution and consistently be on par with the laws passed by this Parliament. The realization of ANC's policies and programs, which are designed to radically improve the material conditions of our people, require robust and fearless parliamentary oversight over the executive. ANC study groups, where ministers and their deputies participate as ANC MPs, will serve as a platform where difficult questions are asked by MPs to right wrongs even before matters are dealt by portfolio committees. However, similar questions will be advanced with the necessary fierceness and boldness on both the portfolio committees and House plenary platforms. Through a proper use of its majority and the advancement of superior arguments informed by its excellent policies, the ANC should be the only parliamentary party capable and well-placed to drive meaningful executive oversight that ensures significant impact on the lives of the people. Faltering in this resolve is tantamount to outsourcing our parliamentary mandate to the opposition, or needlessly inviting the courts to babysit Parliament. The narrative that the ANC is soft on corruption and allows wrongdoing and maladministration to go unpunished is a reputational damage that an ANC-driven parliamentary oversight must not only undo, but must be seen to be undoing without fear or favor. For the ANC parliamentary caucus to be at the forefront of robust parliamentary oversight, it will require highly disciplined, quality and capable members of parliament. In this regard, the Mthembu lekgotla has directed the Office of the Chief Whip to strengthen caucus support service to support MPs, particularly in areas of research and legal support for study groups, ensure all MPs internalize the new rules, and enforce maximum discipline amongst all of them. Regarding discipline, the Whippery Collective has put in place an attendance tracking and performance evaluation mechanism to drastically curb absenteeism and discourage laziness and idleness. The lekgotla has resolved that MPs who are found by the caucus disciplinary committee to have repeatedly absconded or violated the code of conduct must be recommended to the ANC for their immediate recall from Parliament. The public deserves representatives that takes their parliamentary tasks seriously and demonstrate commitment to serve. This harsher measure seeks to encourage diligence and uprightness, faithful presence in the House and committees, and an attitude of respect and accountability towards the electorate by ANC MPs. MPs who repeatedly demonstrate scant regard for the duties entrusted on them by the electorate must make way for those who are prepared to serve with dedication. The Lekgotla, in its examination of how Parliament currently discharges its constitutional responsibilities towards the public, has resolved to recommend that the institution revisits its programming in relation to the time MPs spend in Parliament versus the time spent in their constituencies. Parliament's current programming is disproportionately skewed in favor of MPs spending more time here in Parliament than interacting with the constituencies they represent. The unintended consequence of this format is that a chasm between MPs and their constituencies is created, which does not augur well for accountability. Constituency outreach is a crucial function of an accountable people's parliament. And therefore, Lekgotla has recommended that parliament look into a possibility of 50-50 balance between the two functions. This recommendation does not in any way underestimate the volume of work, including legislative work and intensive budget processes, which takes place behind the walls of Parliament. The Lekgotla reflected on the functionality of the chief whip of the majority party, particularly in relation to the unique and extraordinary institutional responsibilities placed upon the office in line with our system of Parliament. The office is responsible for certain responsibilities relating to the political management and coordination of the work of Parliament, in addition to the ordinary party tasks, without additional support or resources from the institution of Parliament. There is an existing decision that Parliament ought to provide appropriate support for the office proportional to the institutional functions for which it is responsible. The current situation in which the party is forced to allocate its limited resources to fund institutional functions is not only unsustainable, but also detrimental to the quality of the work of the institution. The Lekgotla discussed the ongoing volatile situation at various institutions of higher learning relating to the protest for free education at that level. The ANC remains unwavering in its commitment for the realization of free higher education for undergraduates from poor and working class families. Free education is already being progressively implemented. No fee education at poor public schools has already been realized, and poor students at all TVET colleges are receiving full bursary grants, which they don't pay back. Students who are on NSFAS receive a full bursary for their final year of study. Next year, about 75% of the student population will not pay any fee increase. The Lekgotla was sympathetic to the demands of the protesting students and has appealed to them to conduct their protest peacefully and within the confines of the law. The lekgotla expressed concern at the adverse effects the ongoing protest will have on this academic year, both for these students, the new students who are set to join these universities next year, and for the country's economy. All key stakeholders are therefore called upon to urgently sit down around the table, find one another, and thresh out a settlement. The HEA Commission into Free Higher Education, which was agreed upon by all stakeholders, is also called upon to accelerate its inquiry and report back to the nation. We understand that the Commission is scheduled to release its interim report during the course of next month, thereby bringing us closer to the solution on this issue. The Minister of Education and Training is also scheduled to make a statement in the National Assembly next week. Caucus calls upon the Portfolio Committee on Higher Education and Training to facilitate dialogue with all stakeholders with a view to find a solution to the current impasse. The Portfolio Committee must also embark on a program of engaging all stakeholders at all institutions of higher learning. We have no doubt that all parties involved in this dispute have the necessary leadership abilities to exercise cool heads and find one another on the most contentious issues underpinning these problems. All stakeholders must do everything necessary to save the current academic year and find a lasting solution for the progressive realization of free education. On the situation at the SABC, the lekgotla endorsed a parliamentary inquiry into the fitness of the board to hold office. The inquiry must be conducted without delay to speedily arrest the collapse of corporate governance and save the institution. The board's continued disregard for the call to immediately rescind the irrational and unlawful decision to appoint the former COO to another position was strongly condemned by the lekgotla. The board's intransigence continues to demonstrate a flagrant disregard and disrespect for Parliament, the judiciary, the executive, and the people of South Africa, and must therefore be stopped. On international forums and the inter-parliamentary relations, the lekgotla has called for a better management of Parliament's international obligations to ensure that such engagements serve our interests. Equally, it is important that our national interests are clearly defined, given the fact that South Africa continues to make significant investments of resources towards conflict resolution in the continent. The selection of South Africa as the host country for the Pan-African Parliament PAP was a significant recognition and triumph for both South Africa and the SADC region. The lekgotla has resolved to engage Parliament and the Department of International Relations and Cooperation to ensure that we continue to improve on our responsibilities as a capable and worthy host of such an august institution of the African people. This must include developing guidelines regarding the protection and welfare of PAP delegates to ensure that they discharge their responsibilities under welcoming conditions. Complaints and dissatisfaction relating to the welfare of PAP delegates must be attended to and swiftly resolved to ensure that both PAP's ability to perform its legislative mandate and South Africa's reputation as a capable and warm host are not compromised. We thank you.
Thank you very much, Chibuk. You will get your copies of the statement. And we will now open for any clarification questions. I recognize you, SABC, Janet, Gay, Ongletre. Okay, the statement was very clear, correct? Four, in that order.
Can I go?
Yes.
Chief Whip, hello. I have to ask a question. I need a response from you regarding what's happened this morning with the NPA and our finance minister. What does the ANC in Parliament have to say about that?
It was not a matter that was discussed at lekgotla, but
yes, obviously that is obviously what has become sort of uppermost in all our minds. If you know, it can't be ignored. If you could just respond to that, and more specifically, if you could just, Zizi Kodwa was on radio, on television this morning, saying, hinting or being interpreted as possibly saying, well, saying the ANC will meet urgently about the matter, and hinting perhaps that the finance minister should consider. Or the question actually is, should he be resigning under the circumstances? What is your view on that? And then secondly, back to the matter at hand on the lekgotla, can you tell us what exactly was decided about the decisions over Nkandla in terms of moving forward and also accepting or dealing with what actually took place in over the past 2 years at Parliament, where there appears there's been some kind of discussion around admitting that things weren't, ANC could have handled it differently. Thanks.
Thanks, Gay Davis, Eyewitness News. I'm pretty much covered on the Finance Minister, and just further to the Nkandla question, because we still have the report that came out of the committee that was exonerating and accepting what the Police Minister had said. So what is the status of that, and is it likely that there will be a resolution before the House to set that aside? I mean, do you reopen the thing? I think we just need some clarity.
Just with regard to strengthening oversight, I was wondering if you took any specific resolutions on steps that you might take. I mean, to be honest, I don't think I've ever heard a Chief Whip saying that there shouldn't be robust oversight over the executive. You know, those are the kinds of things that people tend to say, so I'm wondering if there are particular resolutions around that. For example, you know, the AG comes here every year when he presents his general report and complains that there's no follow-up on consequence management,
yes.
That kind of thing. Thanks very much.
Well, the thanks. Do we have a statement? More statements? That's it. Yes. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. Let's start with a question that has been answered by the courts. The courts declared that report invalid. So whatever we do, it is invalid. So what we are dealing with is, indeed, should we have acted in the manner we acted ourselves. It's water under the bridge now that indeed the courts said that we should not have acted in the manner we acted as Parliament, particularly the ANC component of Parliament. We should not have agreed with the report of the Minister of Police on Nkandla. We have said so ourselves that this is one area that made us to lose our own credibility as members of Parliament as members of the ANC here in Parliament. It's something that we should not have done. It's something that we will not do. It's something that we are underlying in what you are asking. that we will not do anything that questions first the Constitution or any law that we ourselves have passed. We should not do such things moving forward, so that our people will know that their representatives are in line with the Constitution, and the oversight that we will conduct is also in par with all our laws underpinned by the Constitution of the land. So that's what we will do. And we commit ourselves to doing this, where we will not, under any circumstances, be once again found to be on the wrong side of the law or the Constitution, as the Constitutional Court said, by the way, on the judgment regarding our report on Nkandla. It said we were on the wrong side of the Constitution and the law. So we will not again be found to be on the wrong side of the law or the Constitution. If there is another mechanism to say what the Constitutional Court has already said on the report, we have no difficulty. If we need to remove what is there, what is removed by our judges already, because it's removed by our judges already. It has been, the report has been set aside. There is the report that is in our archives of Parliament has no force in law. So we cannot do anything empowered by that report, because the courts have declared that that report is invalid. Our response on the NPA, you did receive the statement of the ANC. We stand by the statement of our organization on this matter. Save to also say that many of us respect the honesty of PG, our Minister of Finance, whilst we are, of course, requesting that there should be cooperation between those who are charged and those who are charging. From where I sit as a person, I have a lot of respect for Comrade PG. He's a stalwart of our movement. And again, as the statement of the ANC says, he remains innocent until proven guilty. And I'm convinced where I'm seated, that is an honest man. Of course, let's allow the law to take its course. But I'm still convinced that PG is a wonderful person, is an honest person. Let's see what gets out of the law process. Probably these statements that we are saying could be proved by the outcome of what has now started. We will be with him, some of us, all the way to wherever he's going. We'll accompany him there, if need be, to the courts. As an ANC comrade, as a cadre of our movement, as a disciplined cadre of our movement, and as a wonderful finance minister. I'm speaking, and as Moloto says, this matter did not arise in the lekgotla. It arose today. So I'm speaking on this matter as Jackson Mthembu, a person who serves with PG in the National Executive Committee of the ANC. Therefore, of course, it has been said that there will also be ANC meetings, etc., etc. We are looking forward to those meetings. But again, as ANC, we are saying, if the law has got to take its course, let's take its course. Let all those who are charged cooperate. but it does not take away the respect and the integrity of Comrade PG from where I stand. Thank you.
I apologize for the colleagues on the left for getting these statements late. The right is always advantaged. It's comparable to the left. So. Second round. Let's start from the left.
Thanks, Mildo.
Extreme left.
He's ultra on my left. You'll go first and then...
Chief Whip Lester from ANCA, with the announcement of the summons this morning and part of our parliamentary oversight, do you think this will have any effect on the minister's medium-term budget expected to be tabled on the 26th? In the preparation for this budget, do you think this would have any effect on that, and also then on Parliament discussing that medium-term budget?
These matters have hijacked our press conference.
Mm-hmm. Of course, they were going to to be expected.
Yeah. Are you covered with your following? Okay. Only one question. Okay, and this evening, and then you want a follow-up on this evening, on what this evening goes to?
Absolutely. See what she's going to ask.
Okay, and then you do a follow-up on her question. That's good.
And it's away from City Press. Can I ask on the issue of strengthening the caucus? You say you need highly disciplined, quality and capable MPs, and then you talk about strengthening caucus staff, support services, sorry. And now, I remember 2 years ago, you were not a chief whip at the time, Jackson, but the chief whip at the time spoke about asking Parliament to increase funding to the ANC exactly for this purpose to strengthen. How far did that go? Is this the same thing that you're talking about here in the statement today? You're asking for that extra funding from Parliament to strengthen the staff. But also on the programming, which you said is disproportionate, really skewed. You find MPs spending more time here than constituent offices. Have you not thought of maybe getting less recess and, you know, you can get more time working in Parliament and in constituent offices? Thank you.
Okay. Just to follow up questions on the issues that are coming up. The one is about, in the press statement, this is dealing with your lekgotla. You talk about trying to avoid court cases and doing the role of oversight and having a sort of looking at some of the issues like Nkandla, which could have been done differently by MPs. What else came up as shortcomings over the past, say, 2 years? What were the other matters that perhaps could have not been burdened by the courts? So just if you could give us some more examples, I would imagine the SABC could be one, but there are others. If you could just give us those examples. And then secondly, on the issue of the, sorry, I forgot my notes on it. With the MPA, the MPA is coming before the committee tomorrow in justice. So if you talk about what oversight, if MPs must play the role of oversight, what should MPs be asking tomorrow at the in the meeting about in the wake of the charging of PG, as you put it? Thanks.
Okay. Yes. Three. You want to be the fourth before we close the round?
Thank you very much. Kulehan Mokopani from Business Day. I just wanted to ask regarding what you said about the kind of members that the caucus does not want representing the party, and things that you've mentioned with regards to discipline and even tardiness in doing work in Parliament. To what extent, if any, do you think ministers themselves hold responsibility in that regard? Because many other members have complained that ministers would be no-shows in the House, and if they do show up, they they either avoid questions by not answering or trying to find spurious grounds on which not to answer questions. So to what extent, if any, do you think ministers would be responsible for that, and how to work around that now that it's business unusual, you say? Thank you.
Maybe let's start. When we talk about MPs of the ANC and members of caucus, they cut across. So they will mean everyone. You will expect all of us to act as ANC MPs that our constituencies will be proud of. Whether we answer questions, whether we are participating in the debates in the House, whether we are participating in the portfolio committees. So all of us, you will know that we need to give our people reason that they have sent a delegation here in Parliament that serves their interest. So therefore, we must up the bar, we must up our game. Immaterial, whether we are ministers or we are deputy ministers or we are ordinary MPs, all of us have a responsibility to act in the interest of our people. So that will speak to everybody. We would like to speak to many examples. We made one example. But in the areas of our work, have we really found reasons to hold those who have not acted on the Auditor General's reports? And have we acted on those people? Has there been consequence management? You will know that there are many entities and departments that are coming before Parliament now. We'll be looking at the annual reports of 14-15 and see what is it that they had promised the country. What is it that they have done? What are the programs that they have put in place? Were they able to meet the programs that they themselves had crafted? If not, why not? Have there been any consequences on any maladministration or on any mishandling of funds? These financial resources that we as Parliament have allocated to various entities and departments. So we will be a little bit harder. If actions has not been taken, we will need very good reasons why actions have not been taken. If we ourselves can take action on those that are not giving good service to our people, if we have such authority, we will use such authority. Because ultimately, those that the buck stops with, have they acted in the interest of our people? This will be our attitude. And we are hopeful that even our own people who come from the same party, as they come to Parliament, they will know that they are coming to a people that is going to hold them accountable. Where we collide in these reports, annual reports, where we collide against maladministration, we will ensure that maladministration is acted upon and is not allowed to pester and pester and pester. Where we come across unethical transactions in the oversight that we conduct here in the departments or in entities. By the way, you will see as parties with the ANC in attendance, how we have dealt with the issue of the South African Broadcasting Corporation. We are saying this type of our approach on oversight will not only be limited to a few people called the SABC. So anybody who comes to us who have not done what they are expected to do, they must know that the Parliament of this Republic will hold them accountable. And if there are actions that are needed to correct their wrongdoing, will not be found wanting in calling for such action as Parliament, as we have done on the SAPC. You will also know that on appointments of people to institutions supporting our democracy and other institutions or other boards, one thing that we have come for criticism on is how non-transparent we were as Parliament. We're very non-transparent. We will only bring a report before the House that in relation to this Chapter 9 or to this board, these are the people that we are requesting Parliament to approve. You yourselves have been very critical on our processes. Not only yourselves, but people of South Africa said that they were not consulted through our public participation model on the people that we appoint in public institutions as Parliament. You will know that one good thing, because it's not all bad and ugly, there are also some little good things we have done. You will know, as I do, that on the public protector we did well in terms of process. We involved our people in South Africa, but we also involved non-governmental organizations, community-based formations. They were able to be part of the processes that ultimately gave rise to the wonderful new public protector we have now, Advocate Busi Mkhwebane. So she is an outcome of a process that involved everyone. We would like that process of the public protector to be the DNA of Parliament, so that whether you talk about the Human Rights Commission, commissioners that Parliament must appoint in not so much of a distant future, the same principle of public participation must evolve, and indeed all our people must see Parliament being transparent in conducting its activities around the appointments of people into our public institutions. So we are not just saying things that the Lekgotla has said. We have already demonstrated as Parliament that our heart is in the right place. All that we are assuring fellow South Africans is that the ANC caucus Lekgotla has in fact directed us that we must do things this way, in a transparent way, in relation to appointments. In relation to oversight, the caucus has said, what we have done in the SABC must not only be with the SABC. Do the same with departments, all of them. Do the same with entities, all of them. But of course, give praise. You know, there are many entities, by the way, that are not spoken about, who do wonderful work, who don't receive adverts, reports from the Auditor General, and who are a wonderful citizen in South Africa. We don't say much. We must say so as Parliament when we oversight entities that are doing their job in South Africa. We must speak jointly about those. But conversely, those entities that are not serving the public good, we must come on their necks like 100 bricks of tongues. And that's what we will do. If Parliament doesn't do that, who will? Because it's only Parliament that can fulfill that responsibility of oversight. Now, we are not only talking about entities of state. We are also talking about departments. Some who are supposed to do political oversight on those entities. What did they do when the entities just off-ramped from good governance? Where were they? Were they sleeping on the job? Departments that are paying attention to entities under their jurisdiction, indeed, we will ululate them. We will speak glowingly about them. But those who do nothing, they will also come for criticism by ourselves. And if there is a mechanism of consequence management that relates to departments and entities at our disposal, we will not shy away from acting on entities, will not shy away from acting on departments if the laws of our land give us such a possibility. Parliament constituency, by the way, we're saying the issue of the time spent here in Parliament and time that we need for constituency work, these two, these matters should be looked at properly by Parliament. Our people have various difficulties and challenges that they are faced with on a day-to-day basis where we come from. So one of the important functions of a parliamentarian is serving the communities in your constituencies. So we are saying Parliament must look into this matter. Should we come here and sit here the whole year and only have 2 weeks or 3 weeks there and there in our constituencies, or should there be another model that attends to this grievance? This grievance has been raised a number of times, by the way, not only by the ANC, but by other parties as well. So all that we are saying to Parliament, look at the model now of constituency and Parliament work and see how best can we ensure that constituency work is also given the necessary focus in our program. So I don't know what was that question about NPA. Oh, NPA is coming here tomorrow. Well, we have a committee that deals with such matters. I don't serve in that committee. But be that as it may, the Parliament doesn't have jurisdiction on charging or not charging people. Such a matter resides with a particular state entity. Yes, I know that they will be coming here, but I don't think that the parliamentary committee responsible for this area of work will now off-ramp from holding them accountable in what they have come here to present. I think they'll be coming here to present issues of how they performed in the past financial year, whether were they able to meet whatever programs that they had put before South Africans. So that's what they'll be coming here for. I don't think that they'll be coming here on what they pronounced today. So they'll be coming here on something else. So as to what the committee will engage with them on, we leave that to the capable committee of parliament.
All right, good afternoon. Those were live visuals from Parliament of the ANC briefing the media on its midterm lekgotla. And we've just witnessed ANC chief whip there, Jackson Mthembu, who was speaking about some of the many things that were discussed at the party's lekgotla. We'll definitely have more of those clips right here on news today. Let's take a quick ad break. We're back with more news on top of the hour.
Well, the minister comes. It happens in the relevant portfolio of Parliament, finance, and therefore we are looking forward to the minister presenting his medium-term budget policy statement in October. From where we are seated, there has not been any change of plans. So the minister is still expected, from a programming of parliament point of view, to make that medium-term budget policy statement in October, so that we have a sense, where are we, how did we basically work in relation to the budget since February? Are we on track moving forward to March next year, or what were issues that were discovered in the 6 months of the budget having been passed by Parliament? So indeed the minister must come and fulfill that responsibility in the House. So far, that is programmed in the program of Parliament, notwithstanding what has happened today. The minister is expected to come and give us that budget medium-term policy statement. Just one issue. Caucus staff, we are not asking for money. We are saying that already we have reported to the lekgotla that one issue that we did not process properly at the level of the caucus was getting the necessary research capacity to assist members of the ANC with policy research, ANC policy research, so that when members of the ANC get onto the podium of parliament, they speak from an ANC policy perspective. What was amiss was our research capacity as caucus. We are now interviewing, in fact already we'll be appointing probably next week or so about 12 researchers, and before the end of the year, we would have finished a complement of 24 researchers. That indeed will make caucus support services to be able to give the necessary support to our parliamentarians in this area that you were asking about. So we are very pleased and happy that such support to our members is now coming to the fore.
Thank you, Jacob. Last round, you'll go first, and then if you're the second, Lester, you want to come?
No,
again, you'll be the third, and then you'll be the fourth. So four hands, last round.
Thanks, I'm from Reuters. I'm trying to find it. Where has this pricking of the conscience sort of come from? Is it now a new moral and ethical high ground that is being taken, or is it because of the political social conditions that has helped advance this sort of thing? I mean, how do you convince MPs now to act in the interest of the public, as opposed to acting in their own interest or in their party political interest? And if we were to believe what you are suggesting, then surely the ultimate arbiter of acting in the self or in acting in the interest of the country would be for ANC MPs to, let's say, on an abortion matter, to vote over their conscience sort of thing. But is that not in ultimately what should happen? That so if I can use a hypothetical situation. If the if there is another, whatever, if there's a move to have the president relieved of his position, because he has not acted in the interest of the country, will an ANC MP individually be able to exercise a vote of conscience? Is that what you're saying? Or not? Or we will still follow what essentially what the ruling party says and what they dictate at the end of the day?
Okay.
Babalo from the Times. Chief Whip, regarding discipline and what the Whip Party Collective has put in place, attendance. And do you have an idea, or do you have a head count of MPs that are guilty of this tendency of absenteeism? And is it ordinary MPs? Is it deputy ministers? Is it ministers? And does it apply to Mamuweni Madikizela Mandela? Or is she an honorary MP? Or is she doing constituency work?
Chief, I'd just like to know what's your analysis of questions to the president during the president's question time. There have been lots of critiques on the ANC's caucus in so-called sweetheart questions to the president. I'd just like to know what's your analysis and what would be a remedy, if any, on that matter.
My first question is tied to the question that Lester just asked on the president's session time. I mean, we normally see chaos before he goes on to answer the questions. Was that issue discussed at all on, I don't know, what to do about it from the ANC side? But also on 20 MPs, for Jackson, I mean, every ANC chief, you know, talks tough. And time again, MPs don't go to the House. The ANC, you know, when there's controversial bills or contested bills, you struggle to get quorum in the National Assembly. So what, how are you, because also from your own side as a leadership, you never follow through. You make these threats, and when it comes to implementing them, it doesn't really happen. And also, you said, I don't see it in the speech, but you spoke about discussing a new player in Parliament. Who are you talking about? Is that AIC? Ahang. Yes, he said there's a new player in Parliament. So I just wanted to know who are you talking about and what were those discussions. And lastly, I find it very interesting that you say, Jackson, you will accompany PG to the court. Some of us will accompany him. We believe in him and so on. Why? I mean, the courts are competent to deal with the matter, aren't they? Why do you need to go to accompany him to court? Thanks.
Okay, because it's the last round, we're going to make sure that everybody is covered. You will be the fifth and then the sixth head. Okay, and Paul.
Good, thanks. I'm not sure whether it's been canvassed. I'm sorry, I had to go out to file. The issue of the president being found to be in breach of his constitutional obligations and his oath of office, what, given what we've heard here today, does the ANC caucus intend to do in Parliament about that? And equally, that also applies to Parliament itself. That's the one question. I'm not sure if it's already being put. Secondly, I mean, like Adesiwe, I mean, we've heard successive whips, chief whips speaking about the need to beef up the caliber of the MPs, better discipline, and so on. And, you know, here we still sit. Are you, I mean, what actually sort of are you going to put in place, apart from the threat of sanctions, which clearly haven't seemed to have worked? I mean, are you going to be looking at reviewing your parliamentary cadres? Thanks.
You dealt with those questions when you were
outside. Yeah.
Just my luck.
Good afternoon, Chief. Paul Vickyard from Bloomberg. Just, first of all, Jimmy, you talked about transparency. But transparency is not just including everybody, it's also certain people you may decide to exclude for various reasons. And there's been a lot of commentary and objections about the presiding officers. For instance, I believe the Speaker of the NA was within the caucus. I don't know if any other presiding officers were. I think it was appropriate to have them there, notwithstanding the fact they are MPs and ANC members. But, you know, the other opposition parties have objected strongly to the perceived biasness of the presiding officers, which has resulted in court cases, which Parliament has lost. Did you discuss this at all in any way, and if so, any solution to this? Thank you.
Okay, six hands, last round, and then with them.
No, we have said in terms of new players, there are new players in the fifth parliament, so there are many. There are people who have just come in since 2014, so of course bringing in some some new approach to how business is done in Parliament, and in some instances some approach that might not give value to the business of Parliament. So, but of course we are saying you cannot look at your own performance without looking at who are you performing against. It will be in the area of self-evaluation. So you are performing against some people here in Parliament as the ANC. And if you don't act in a manner that differentiate you and those people, people might not see the difference between you and any other person in Parliament. The ANC has a history, the ANC has a track record, but that alone does not make people to have any trust in the ANC. What will make people have trust in the ANC is what the ANC here in Parliament does on a day-to-day basis. Compared to all players that are here, to all new players that are here, how we ourselves do our work here and whether we are doing such work informed by the policies of the African National Congress. Again, as you talk of issues of conscience, we are all coming here not as conscientious objectors, but we are here on the list of the African National Congress. The same will apply to other parties. Being on that list of the ANC that brought us here, that list says, amongst other things, we must act without any fear or favor on anything called corruption. We should. That list says we must act without any fear or favor on anything that we come across that might be referred to as maladministration in the departments that we hold oversight on or entities. So all that we are saying that indeed we will. We will do so without any fear or favor. The very African National Congress has passed a myriad of laws that are meant to better the lives of our people. It will therefore be untoward for any ANC delegation here in Parliament to act not in par with the legislations that we have crafted ourselves. So that's all that we're saying. Whatever we do here in Parliament must be informed by our laws, must be informed by our constitution, but also must be informed by the standing of our organization within our people as a liberator, as an organization that fights for the rights of all South Africans and an organization that would like to ensure that those that are poor, their poverty is reduced from the corners of our country. This is what should inform our work and of course also transformation in our country, in all sectors of our economy and sectors of our lives, so that we don't continue from time to time to find ourselves back in an apartheid South Africa, back in a colonized South Africa. As the African National Congress, we are therefore an important instrument to transform our country. We must therefore use this policy advantage of the ANC as parliament to do this oversight everywhere where we interact with our entities and also where we interact with our departments, to take forward the policy direction of the ANC. I can assure you, and it's not only the ANC that has talked about the good quality and meaningfulness of the policies of the ANC. Many people have talked about this, where people have found us as parliament, have found the executive and the entities wanting, is in the implementation of these very good policies of the African National Congress. We are saying we must not be found wanting. We must ensure as the ANC contingent here that these policies of the ANC are implemented. They are there. We are not coming here without any policies. All of us know that we have wonderful, excellent policies whose implementation leaves a lot to be desired, and in many instances we as parliament and ANC contingent of parliament have not found people wanting for the non-implementation of our own policies. That is the issue that we are raising, and I think it answers your say too, because we are not freebies. We are all mandated by the ANC to be here. As far as our mandate goes, we must act in relation to this mandate that we derive from our deployment here. And that mandate is in all ANC policies should be leading the work of all departments in government. So we must be oversighting that. We must be ensuring that those policies are implemented. And through implementation of those policies, our view is that therefore the lives of our people can be improved for the better. Sweet questions. Again, how do you make your policy direction stand in the public domain when you are unable to answer very hard questions on your policies and implementation of your policies? Again, an answer to your question, whether it's questions to the president or questions to any member of the executive, we expect from ANC members, first of all, that they will obviously know what are the ANC policy articulations in any area. But the intention of an ANC question is to put in the public domain what strides have we made to change lives of our people for the better. That is the objective. And so that it's not the minister or the MP or the president who shines after having answered the question. In fact, the organization that must shine is the African National Congress, because people of South Africa must see that through its policies, people in South Africa have been able to advance to a better life. And if we can ask right questions, not sweet questions, we can be able to inform South Africans through those questions and answers that South Africa is not where it was 22 years ago in various areas of our endeavors. That should be the object of our questions, not to do any other thing, but to put in the public domain the good work that has been done by an ANC government. But of course, it's in the nature of life. You might have good policies, you might have wonderful people who even implement those policies. You might not necessarily have the finances to take forward your wonderful policies. So what have been the challenges in implementation of those policies? But where the policies have not been implemented because people were corrupt, we must fight as ANC. Where the policies have not been implemented because people decided to disregard Auditor General after Auditor General's report, as ANC, there must be consequence management by those responsible. And if they don't take action, what is possible for us as Parliament here to act where there are omissions? Discipline. You know, in many instances, we have been able to pass what we're expected to. There are instances where we're not, because some MPs were not in the House. But how many? So that we don't create an impression that the majority of MPs from the ANC are truant members of Parliament. No, that cannot be true. Many members of the ANC who are in that Parliament attend to their parliamentary duties. They attend to the ANC responsibilities here. They also attend to the Portfolio Committee or Select Committee's responsibilities. There'll be a blessed few and very few. And again, we will not discuss names here. Those few are now appearing before our DC of caucus. They are now before our DC of caucus, and we are saying in our statement, if they continue to repeat their disregard for the responsibilities that they carry, the lekgotla has said, send them packing. Go to the organization. There are some who come through the national list. There are some who come through provincial list. After everything that you have done here, then speak to the organization so that the organization can recall these MPs who are regular in these omissions, so that you get better people. So that's what we're going to do. We were just informing you. But the process of disciplining truant MPs has started. There are many MPs, about five or six, who have been quite in and out of hospital for various reasons. And we do have their records from their doctors. That's one of the functions I must fulfill as a chief whip. When you are not here and you claim to be sick and you are seeing a doctor, I must have the doctor's records. For many comrades who are seeing doctors who could not be here precisely because they are having difficulties with their health, that includes Mamwini, by the way. We have her records. We have her records from her doctors. It's not only her. We wouldn't like to mention others, but it's not only her, there are many, about five or six, who fall into that category. But we are not including those comrades in the category of delinquent MPs, please. Those are not. The delinquent MPs are MPs who will come all the way to Cape Town from everywhere else, to come and attend study groups, to come and attend portfolio committee meetings, to come and attend the sitting of parliament here, and all of a sudden they are not where they are supposed to be, and you find them elsewhere, probably waterfront or wherever. So that qualifies for truant and delinquent MPs. Mamwene doesn't fall into that category. And many others who have given us their sick records and sick notes from their doctors. But those who fall under that category are being attended to as we speak. The DC of caucus is busy with them, and there are some that we will request our organization that has sent us here to perhaps recall. Where does this change? That there is no change of heart, by the way. Our people have spoken and have spoken eloquently about us as a movement. Our people have said we must go back to the drawing boards and self introspect and do things that will naturally make us a leader of society. When our people voted in a particular way on the 3rd of August, when our people, many of them, did not go to the polls, they were indeed indicating their displeasure with us as a movement. There are many things that we are doing at other levels of our organization, but we are doing something here in Parliament because the ANC has sent us here in Parliament. Our people have said we can do better. We can do better oversight over the executive, but we can also be better parliamentarians. And this is what we think we can. That's what we must be, because we can be better parliamentarians. But our people have said that we must also be in constant touch with them, so that we are not away from them and their challenges and their difficulties. We are busy here with notices of motion and whatever else that we do here, instead of attending to their day-to-day difficulties that they are confronted with on a day-to-day basis. That is covered in the statement, that we need to find a balance between us being here and us being with our people there, so that they can also tell us what more and what else should we do as their members of Parliament, apart from holding the executive accountable, apart from doing all the other things that we do here in Parliament, in our own constituencies. What are these other things that our people would like us to do on their behalf there? I'm deployed at a place called Marisbeck, and the village is Vulindlela. That's where my constituency is. And indeed, as ANC caucus, we think that many of us should spend more time with our constituencies and do real practical work there, bringing together the national sphere of government, the provincial sphere of government, and the local sphere of government, and various bodies that impact on the lives of our people. It's only an MP that can do that, by the way. An MP working with MPLs, an MP working with councillors in a local area. It's us that can impact positively in the lives of our people where they are. Apart from the broad parliamentary work that we do here, we are saying we need to go there where our people are, so that we also bridge the distance between ourselves and our people. We need to bridge that distance. And again, the ANC at national level is talking about ways of bridging this distance, but we as parliamentarians coming from the ANC, we think the best way of bridging that distance, amongst others, is creating a possibility for us to be in our constituencies. But that should not impact negatively to the work that we have to do here in Parliament. Somebody asked chaos before questions to will we see this chaos continuing? You will know that we are also empowered by caucus and its lekgotla, that we must also engage with anyone and everyone to avoid parliament becoming something that it is not. Our parliament is a house of debate. Our parliament is a house that passes legislation. Our parliament is not a house of insults. So indeed, we are speaking to other parties. We are saying when our people, all of them, look at us engaging in their parliament, they must see us engaging in their parliament, us respecting their parliament, not turning their parliament into something else. We are engaging with all other parties in this regard. You will know that the speaker, in her capacity as the head of the institution and the chair of the NCOP, have also met with various parties in relation to this particular matter. They have met with all of us, and on ourselves, we have also consulted with other parties. At the end of the day, Parliament is about changing the lives of our people for the better through oversight over the executive and nothing else. And all of us seem to be in agreement with that. So we'll be pursuing that matter with other parties so that we do everything we can to ensure that Parliament reverts to this house that it is supposed to be. Why accompany PG? He's my friend and my comrade. Nothing wrong with that. In fact, I will. He's my friend, he's my comrade. We are both in the National Executive Committee of the ANC, but more importantly, in my view, as the ANC statement says, he is innocent. Of course, in our laws, we are innocent until proven guilty. So there is nothing wrong. Presiding officers, well, one issue we discussed, by the way, at the lekgotla, is in our current constitutional dispensation, the speaker is appointed in a particular way by the House. Therefore, there is no obligation on the speaker when she is so appointed as it is now that she must then resign from her party political office and be neutral. We are in agreement with that notion. That's what is happening throughout the country. Unless we want to change the constitution to bring another dispensation in relation to the election of a speaker of the house. The issue of presiding officers being biased, I can assure you, from where the ANC is seated, the ANC doesn't need any biasness from anybody. We don't. Like I've said, by the way, the ANC has got the best policies. We don't want anybody favoring us with any bias. It's not in our interest. We don't want anybody. We want and from where we are seated, we have not experienced any favor from anybody. At any rate, let me assure you, if you are a good team and you are playing against another team, and the referee decides to favor you, I think it would be insulting to some of us who are leading that team. Because the referee, we expect that the referee should be unbiased and act in terms of the rules of parliament. In our view, the presiding officers are of course also human beings, but they act in terms of the rules of parliament, and I don't believe that the ANC in any way has been favored. Some of us will be totally against that because we believe that we are up to the task. We don't need to be assisted by any presiding officer to do what is expected of us as parliament or as ANC contingent here in parliament. We don't need anybody. We need ourselves. It's us who prepare for debates. It's us who prepare for engagements in the portfolio committees. It's us who prepare for engagements in the select committees. All these presiding officers are not there. It's us who even agree on what report must come before Parliament, whether the NA or the NCOP. Presiding officers are not there. They only come when we bring these reports, when we also say who are going to debate these reports. And all that they are expected to do by law is agree to give us the time as agreed in the whippery, that you speak for 3 minutes, you speak for 4 minutes, what. So their role in being biased in the House is very, very minimal, to say the least. But as an ANC chief whip, if there were to be any speaker who were to be biased on in favor of the ANC, that would be insulting to the movement, because we don't need such biasness. All we need is any presiding officer should do what is expected by the rules of the House and conduct the business of the House. By the way, there are some members of the ANC who at times feel that some presiding officers at least are acting not favorably against the ANC. But we are saying that is neither here nor there. We want presiding officers to do what they are expected of by our rules and the Constitution of the Republic. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for coming. Thank you, Chief Whip, for your responses. Aman.
Go ahead. What is that? Is that Afrikaans? And as an Afrikaans brat?
From Shanghai, because Shanghai.